Hello everyone, welcome to Department of Collegiate Education Digital Learning Management System. I am Dr. E. Srinivas. In this video, I am going to explain first law of thermodynamics, which is a chapter for first BSc students. In this video, I am going to explain what is internal energy and statement of first law of thermodynamics, its explanation, significance of first law of thermodynamics, and its limitations. First of all, what is internal energy? Because to understand the first law of thermodynamics, the concept of internal energy is very, very important. You all know that according to kinetic theory of matter, the matter is made up of large number of tiny particles called molecules. These molecules are always in a state of random motion inside the system. The motion may be translational, that is along straight line, rotational, they may rotate about their own axis, and also are vibrational, they vibrate about their mean position. Hence, the molecules possesses a kinetic energy due to their random motion. So, due to random motion, the molecules possesses kinetic energy. As the temperature increases, the average kinetic energy of the gas molecules also increases. As the temperature increases, the velocity or average velocity of the molecules increases, hence kinetic energy of the gas molecules also increases. Thus, the internal energy of a gas is a function of its temperature. It is very, very important. Internal energy is always depends on temperature. As temperature increases, internal energy of the gas increases. As temperature decreases, the internal energy also decreases. So, next, let us talk about the potential energy. The molecules of a real gas exert mutual force of attraction on one another. Hence, they possesses intermolecular potential energy. So, molecules of a real gas exert mutual force of attraction between them. Due to mutual force of attraction between them, they possesses molecular potential energy. That means, work has to be done against the intermolecular force of attraction. So, that work done against intermolecular force of attraction to separate them is stored in the form of potential energy. If the volume of the gas increases, work is done by the gas against intermolecular attraction, and so its potential energy increases. If the volume of the gas increases, potential energy increases. Thus, the intermolecular potential energy of a real gas is a function of its volume. Intermolecular potential energy of a real gas is a function of volume, whereas kinetic energy is a function of temperature. The sum of internal kinetic energy and potential energy is known as internal energy of the system, denoted by U. So, the total internal energy of the system is the sum of the internal kinetic energy and internal potential energy of all the molecules inside the system is known as internal energy of the system, denoted by U. Thus, internal energy may be defined as the energy possessed by its molecular constitution and position of their molecules. So, it is the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy of all the molecules in the system, the another definition is that internal energy may be defined as the energy possessed by its molecular constitution and position of their molecules. Or the internal energy U of a system is the sum of the kinetic and potential energies of its atoms and molecules. Recall that kinetic plus potential energy is called mechanical energy. So mechanical energy is divided into two types, potential energy and kinetic energy. So by recalling the mechanical energy is the sum of potential energy and kinetic energy, here the internal energy is also the sum of atomic and molecular mechanical energy. Internal energy is the sum of atomic and molecular mechanical energy. So next we will discuss about the first law of thermodynamics. So the first law of thermodynamics is a particular case of the general principle of conservation of energy. So you all know that what is conservation of energy? Energy neither be created nor be destroyed. The total energy of the system remains constant, although it can be transferred from one form to another form. The first law of thermodynamics is a particular case of the general principle of conservation of energy, means the total energy of the system always constant and energy neither be created nor be destroyed. This is very important. First law of thermodynamics is a particular case of general law of conservation of energy. Statement. It states that the heat energy given to a system is equal to the sum of the increase in internal energy and the external work done by the system. For a very small change in the state of the system, the law is expressed in the differential form as dQ is equal to dU plus dW. That means if dQ amount of heat is supplied to the system, a part of it is utilized by the system to increase its internal energy and the remaining part is utilized in doing work by the system. If dU is the change in internal energy or increase in internal energy and dW is the work done by the system or done on the system, then dQ is equal to dU plus dW. This is a mathematical form of the first law of thermodynamics. Once again, if heat energy given to a system is equal to the sum of the increase in internal energy dU and the external work done by the system, that is dW, for a very small change in the state of the system, the law is expressed in the differential or mathematical form as dQ is equal to dU plus dW, where dQ is the amount of heat supplied to the system or amount of heat absorbed by the system, and dU is the increase in internal energy and dW is the work done by the system. In this diagram, we can see that here heat Q or dQ is supplied to the system. In that dU, a part of that heat is utilized by the system to increase its internal energy and remaining amount is utilized in doing work. Here consider the cylinder fitted with a frictionless piston and this cylinder enclosed by a gas. When heat is supplied to this gas contained in a cylinder, in the beginning the internal energy of the system increases as temperature increases, and the remaining part is utilized in doing work, means so as the volume increases, the piston, due to expansion of the gas, the piston moves through or displaced through certain distance, gives rise to work done, because work done is equal to force into distance. Here also Q is equal to another form, U1 minus U2. So initial internal energy minus final internal energy gives rise to change in internal energy plus W work done. Here also Q is the amount of heat supplied to the system. So the piston is moved through a certain distance. This is the initial position of the piston. This is the final position of the piston. So there is a movement of the piston due to expansion of the gas by the supplying of the amount of heat. Hence there is a work done represented by W. So amount of heat supplied to the system is equal to increase in internal energy or change in internal energy plus work done W. But work done is given by dW is equal to P into dV. How this equation comes? We know that according to, so work done is equal to force into displacement, that is F into dx. Force per unit area is called pressure. So pressure is equal to force by area. Pressure is equal to force by area. So force is equal to pressure into area. So area into dx gives the dv. So dw is equal to P into dv. Once again, work done is equal to force into displacement. F into dx is there. For F, we can write P into A. So P, A into dx. A into dx is dv, change in volume. So dw is equal to PdV. Therefore, you can also write that dq is equal to du plus PdV also, where dq is the quantity of heat energy, du is equal to u1 minus u2, that is internal energy, and dw is the amount of work done. Here, sign conventions used in the first law of thermodynamics. It should be remembered that all the quantities in the above equation must be expressed in unit of energy. So all quantities should be expressed in terms of units of energy. Here the amount of heat Q or dQ is taken as positive if heat is supplied to the system or if heat is absorbed by the system. If the heat is absorbed by the system, then Q or dQ are taken as positive. And negative, if the heat is removed from it, Q or dQ is taken as positive if heat is supplied to the system, and negative if heat is removed from it. Similarly, the work W or dW is positive when the external work is done by the system. This is important. When the external work is done by the system, so work done is positive. That is in expansion. In the expansion of the gas, so work is done by the system and work done is taken as positive. And work done is taken as negative if the work is done on the system, that is in compression. So if you take a gas in a cylinder fitted with a frictionless piston, if in the process of compression, so the work done on it, so then the work done is taken as negative. So work done is taken as positive when the external work is done by the system, that is during expansion. And work done is negative if the work is done on the system, that is in the process of compression. The increase in internal energy of the system is positive. The decrease in internal energy of the system is taken as negative. The increase in internal energy of the system is taken as positive, that is during the heat supplied process, that is expansion. The decrease in internal energy of the system is taken as negative. What are the significance of the first law of thermodynamics? first point or first significance is that it gives the relationship between heat and work. So the first law establishes definite relationship between the heat absorbed and the work performed by a system. You all know that mathematical form of first law of thermodynamics, that is dq is equal to du plus dw. So dq is heat supplied, so du is internal energy and dw is the work done. So it gives the relationship between heat and work. Second significance, it is merely the law of conservation of energy generalized to include heat as a form of energy transfer. So you already know that first law of thermodynamics is generally the law of conservation of energy, that is the total energy of the system remains constant, energy neither be created nor be destroyed, although it can transfer from one form to another form. That is, heat is a form of energy in transit. The energy of an isolated system remains constant. So as I explained, energy is conserved in a thermodynamic system. The fourth significance is that heat and work are different forms of the same entity called energy. So heat can be converted into mechanical work and vice versa. That is, mechanical work can also be converted into energy or heat. So heat and work are different forms of the same entity called energy. And the fifth one, the same point, heat and work are equivalent to each other. So as the significance of four indicate that heat and work are different forms of the same entity called energy, so heat and work are equivalent to each other, like energy and mass are equivalent according to Einstein's mass energy relation. So what are the limitations of the first law of thermodynamics? The first limitation is that it does not indicate the direction of the flow of heat. So you already know that heat always flows from a hot body to a cold body. The first law does not indicate whether the heat can flow from a cold body to a hot body or not. The first law does not indicate whether heat can flow from a cold body to a hot body or not. For example, we cannot extract heat from the ice by cooling it to a low temperature. So heat cannot itself flow from cold body to hot body. We have to do some external work to transfer heat from cold body to hot body. Some external work has to be done to transfer heat from cold body to hot body. So the first law does not indicate the direction of flow of heat. So that is the first limitation of the first law of thermodynamics. What is the second limitation? It does not tell anything about the conditions under which heat can be converted into mechanical work. Under which conditions heat is converted into mechanical work and mechanical converted into heat. It does not tell anything about the conditions under which heat can be converted into mechanical work. And the third limitation is that it also does not say how much of the heat energy can be converted into mechanical work continuously. So we are supplying heat energy to the system or engine. So how much of heat is converted into mechanical work continuously? About this, it does not so tell about that. So practically, it is not possible to convert the heat energy into an equivalent amount of work. So how much percentage of the heat is converted into mechanical work? So that is the third limitation of the first law of thermodynamics. Also, we know that practically it is not possible to convert the heat energy completely into mechanical work. It has been found that no heat engine can convert all the heat extracted from the source into work continuously without rejecting a part of it to the surroundings. So, first law has no answer for this fact. It has been found that no heat engine can convert all the heat extracted from the source into work continuously without rejecting a part of it to the surroundings. So, there is no 100% efficiency by any heat engine practically. So, why it is so like that? First law has no answer for this fact. So, I have used all these books as reference to do this video. And also, in this video, we learnt about internal energy and also the statement of first law of thermodynamics and its significance and also limitations. Thank you for watching. Thank you once again. So, all of you like this video and also thank you for watching.